Okay, so let's start. Last week we discussed the combinatorial patchworking procedure in the case of surfaces. My first goal for the day will be to try to convince you that this construction can be used to create some interesting surfaces in IP3. So the construction I'd like to present is a construction of a maximal surface of degree 4. In fact, I'd like to construct today a surface, a single surface of degree 4, such that the real point set of the surface is homeomorphic to the disjoint union of S10 and S0, so a sphere with 10 handles and a two-dimensional sphere. So let's check that everybody is in the room already waked up. So what is the total Betti number of the real point set of such a surface? So apparently, you didn't yet wake up. 24, right. So and 24 is the total Betti number of the complex point set of a non-single surface of degree 4 in IP3. So our surface is maximal if we succeed to construct such a surface. And so we will use the combinatorial patchworking. And for the moment, probably for you, it's difficult to believe that it's possible to use this combinatorial patchworking in the case of surfaces and be able to see the result and to realize what will be the topological type of the surface under construction. So I'll try to convince you that, in fact, it's perfectly possible. You can use this construction, and we will, in a sense, see that the result has this topological type. But before, let me do some preliminary calculation. In principle, this calculation should be done during the exercise sessions, but since the volume of exercise session is very limited, so let me do this calculation in the case of surface of degree 4 right now, and then during the exercises, you can try to do more general calculation, to do the same calculation in arbitrary degree. So let's assume that in our combinatorial patchworking procedure, we use a primitive triangulation. So it's a primitive, of course, convex primitive triangulation of the tetrahedra, which is the convex hull of points 0, 0, 0, d, 0, 0, 0, d, 0, and 0, 0, d. So primitive means that each tetrahedron of the triangulation is of minimal possible volume for a tetrahedron with integer vertices. That is 1/6. So we choose a primitive convex triangulation of our big tetrahedron T. We also choose a distribution of signs. At the vertices of our triangulation, but since our triangulation is primitive, it means that we should choose a sign for each integer point of this tetrahedron of size d. So, as I said, I will do everything in the case d equal to 4, but you can generalize my calculation to other degrees. So out of this initial data, our combinatorial Pasquini procedure will produce this pink piecewise linear surface, right? And in fact, we will realize some topological pair RP3 Rx. Everybody remembers the construction? Very good. So, claim. Okay, so d is equal to 4. So. And the last letter is A. The early characteristic of the resulting surface, if you want this piecewise linear pink surface, the real point set of our non-singular surface of degree 4 in AP3, so the surface we obtained via this construction. So the early characteristic is minus 16. And then that I don't need to know what is this primitive triangulation. I don't need to know what is the distribution of signs. I am sure that the early characteristic will be minus 16. You can ask me why we didn't discuss such a beautiful phenomenon in the case of curves. What is not true, that we didn't discuss this beautiful phenomenon in the case of curves? Now, but this beautiful phenomenon in the case of curves is also true. So, but first, of course, I didn't yet formulate the beautiful phenomenon, but you can easily guess that for any degree, independently on primitive triangulation you will choose and distribution of signs you will choose, I know the early characteristic. And for degree d, the early characteristic is minus d cube over 3 plus 4d over 3. And we will later realize what is this characteristic for the complex point set of our surface. But I claim that the early characteristic is really determined by the early characteristic of the real point set is determined by the degree, provided that I'm using the combinatorial Pasquini procedure with a primitive triangulation. So it's extremely important that triangulation is primitive. And if we try to formulate this beautiful phenomenon in the case of curves, it's also perfectly true that the early characteristic of the real point set of our curves is determined by the degree. And in fact, it's just always zero, right? The real Poisson set of a non-singular curve in IP2 is always zero because the real Poisson set is a collection of circles. Yeah, so when the dimension of our real Poisson set is odd, this phenomenon, of course, is present, but just the early characteristic is zero. Okay. But if the dimension is even, then we have some interesting results. And so in the case of surfaces, the answer is like this. So the general case is one of the exercises of the last list of exercises you have. So try to do it. But let's do this exercise in the case of degree four. Well, so let's imagine that we have a primitive triangulation. In fact, for this calculation, it will not be important that the triangulation is convex. So we need the convexity of the triangulation to perform the combinatorial perturbation procedure. But to consider this piecewise linear pink surface, we don't really need to assume that the triangulation is convex. My claim is that the early characteristic of this piecewise linear pink surface is, in the case of degree four, is always minus 16, provided that the triangulation is primitive. So let's imagine that we have a primitive triangulation of this tetrahedron. We have some distribution of signs. And then we play our usual game. So we take eight symmetric copies of this tetrahedron. We extend our primitive triangulation. So I will not even try to draw it. So we extend the triangulation we have to a symmetric triangulation of the union of these eight corpus. Then we extend the distribution of signs in the usual way. And then we cook out of this of the union of eight symmetric copies of this tetrahedron, we cook a copy of IP3, identifying opposite points on the boundary. And then we obtain some piecewise linear surface in the union of all these eight symmetric copies, as always. Then we take the image of this pink surface in the quotient space when we identify opposite points on the boundary. So we get some surface. Everything is OK? Everybody follows for the moment? Very good. Well, now our task is to calculate the early characteristic of the resulting surface. So already the description of this surface takes some time. How to calculate the early characteristic of the surface? Well, in fact, this surface comes already with some cellular decomposition, right? Because this construction already provides you some decomposition of our pink surface. This decomposition is, well, cellular decomposition is formed by the intersections of this pink surface with all elements of the triangulation of this big octahedron, union of eight tetrahedron, right? So if we speak about two cells, so cells of maximal dimension, so how they look like? Well, okay, I'll draw it here. So remember that if we have, now this is a tetrahedron of this big primitive triangulation of the union of eight copies of T. So if we have for example three signs plus and one sign minus, then in such a tetrahedron, there is a triangle of our surface, right? So we
If
we have, for example, two pluses and two minuses, then in such a tetrahedron we have a parallelogram. Doesn't look like parallelogram. Of our surface. Right? So in fact, we have two cells of the cell or the composition of our pink surface. So two types of cells. We have triangles and parallelograms. Then, of course, we have one cells, which are intersections of our surface with triangles. And we have zero cells, which are intersection of our surface with edges of the triangulation. So if you want to calculate the Euler characteristic, we should just take the number of two cells minus the number of one cells plus the number of zero cells. Now our task is to calculate the number of two cells, the number of one cells, and number of zero cells. And I claim that all these numbers do not depend on the choice of primitive triangulation or distribution of signs. Well, okay, let's first try to count the number of tetrahedra of the initial triangulation, the triangulation of T, the number of triangles in this triangulation, the number of edges, and the number of vertices. So numbers of simplices in the triangulation of T. So we have tetrahedron, triangles, segments, and vertices. So how many tetrahedra do we have?
Six times the volume.
No. And can I have a number? And not just a way to calculate it.
Yeah. It's a d. D no.
Well, d is 4. That's the simplified terms. I really want a number. No.
So,
64. Yes. So, this is one the normalized volume of this big tetrahedron T. Or if you take the standard volume, you should multiply by. You should multiply by 6. So it's. It's 64. Everybody agrees? So now, what are the number of triangles?
First of all, do you mean two cells or really?
No. So
faces.
I mean what is written?
Oh, in the triangulation.
So I'm counting simplices of our primitive triangulation of T, just to start with. I agree that for the moment it's not clear why I am doing it, but okay, believe me, everything will work. So this is the number of tetrahedra of of the primitive triangulation, we took primitive triangulation of T. I'm just looking at the triangulation of T for the moment. So now, what is the number of triangles? In fact, I will need more detailed information. I will not just need the total number of triangles, but for me it will be important whether this triangle belong to some coordinate plane, or to some face of this tetrahedron, or not. So let's first count the triangles which lie in the faces of T. So this will be inside, this will be in faces. So what is the number of triangles in the faces of T? Okay, in one face, how many triangles do we have?
16.
Right? So the total number? Yeah, we have four faces. In each face, we have 16 triangles, so it's 64. Now we are able to calculate the number of triangles inside. So how to calculate this number? So each tetrahedron has four faces, four triangles. Let's subtract this 64. And then each remaining triangle will be calculated twice because it separates two tetrahedra. So, okay, let's do this calculation here. So it's 64 times 4 minus 64 divided by 2. So it's 96. Okay. So now what happens with segments? So for segments, I will need even more detailed information. I will need to know how many segments do we have inside T, on the faces of T, and on the edges of T. So let's start with edges. How many segments do we have in the edges of T? So each edge of T has four segments. We have six edges, so it's 24. Well, now a difficulties begin. So what is the number of segments in the faces, but not in the edges? Okay, let's do it for one triangle. So this is a face of T. How many segments do you have in this face, but not on the sides of this face? That's a little bit more difficult to calculate, but the key observation is that you know the early characteristic of this triangle. Yeah. The early characteristic is one. You know the number of triangles, you know the number of vertices, so you know the number of edges, right? So try to do the calculation. Okay, my claim that, so do this calculation. I hope it's clear how to do it. So the result for one face is 18. So the total number is 72 because we have four faces. And now the most difficult number is the number of segments lying inside the tetrahedron T. Once again, let's use the this observation that we know the early characteristic of T. So since we know the early characteristic of T, which is 1, to determine this this number, we just need to know the number of total number of vertices, and all the number all other numbers we already do know. So we will be able to determine this number. So in fact, of course, you can extend my calculation and calculate the number of vertices separately inside, in the faces, in the edges, and at the vertices. But well, it's nice, but we don't need it, because in fact we know that we are interested only in tetrahedra, triangles, and segments. Yeah. So here I will write the total number. So total number of vertices. What is the total number of vertices? Well, it's the total number of integer points in T. And as far as I remember, it should be 35. Now, if you do the calculation, so what it should be? So this number minus sum of these numbers plus the sum of these numbers minus this number should be 1. So let's see. Fortunately, this sum is 96, so it disappears. So it disappears, so it's 34.
But T is homeomorphic to sphere.
I'm sorry?
T is homeomorphic to sphere.
No, no, no. T is the whole tetrahedron. It's not just the union of faces. So the early characteristic is really 1. You see, I'm counting tetrahedra. Okay, so this calculation is done. Now, what will I do with this calculation? Well, now an easy lemma an easy lemma to prove the previous lemma. So each tetrahedron of T has exactly 7 non-empty symmetric copies. So of course, I should explain what do I mean by non-empty symmetric copy, but probably you can guess. Just a symmetric copy where there is some piece of our pink surface. So each tetrahedron of T has 8 symmetric copies. As I hope you agree. My claim is that out of this 8 symmetric copies, exactly 1 is empty. Empty meaning that our pink surface is not present there. And all other 7 symmetric copies, there is a piece, well, some number of triangles, some number of parallelograms. So in this 7 symmetric copies, we have pieces of our pink surface. So I will not prove it, but it's an easy exercise. Think about it. In fact, it's a good exercise to give to the first year students when they learn linear algebra. So in fact, it's an exercise in linear algebra, and the base field is F2. So Think about it, but you can easily understand this statement in the case where our tetrahedron is the standard one, so with vertices 0, 0, 0, 1, 0001001. Right, so what does it mean that a copy is empty? It means that all the signs are the same. Right? So, and it's clear that for this tetrahedron that there is exactly one symmetric copy like this. Right? Because each time you consider the reflection with respect to some coordinate plane, you change one sign. So if you want all signs to coincide with the sign of the origin, you just take the corresponding reflections in the corresponding octant, you have this unique symmetric copy. But in fact, it's a completely general statement. And there are also corresponding statements for triangles, segments, and so on. So each triangle I'm writing each tetrahedron of T, I mean each tetrahedron of our triangulation of T, of course. So now each triangle of our triangulation of T, if this triangle lies inside T, has how many non-empty symmetric copies? Any guesses? A hint, the total number of copies is 8.
There's 8 permutations of signs, right? So 2 or 6?
Good. Six non-empty symmetric copies. In fact, we are also interested in triangles belonging to some phase of T. How many symmetric copies, non-empty symmetric copies now? Think about a triangle lying, for example, in this horizontal coordinate plane. So in this case, you can forget everything except this horizontal plane. And so in this case, you are just working with the corresponding construction of a curve in the plane, right? And so we just think about symmetric. So we have just 4 symmetric copies of our triangle. And how many of them are non-empty? So the same calculation as for the tetrahedra. Out of these 4 copies, exactly 1 is empty for the same reason as before. So in this case, we have 3 non-empty symmetric copies. So if you want, this 3 is just 6/2. Right? So since our triangle is in the face of T, instead of 8 copies, we have just 4 copies because we have, in fact, secretly 4 pairs of coinciding triangles, right? Because we identify some. So in principle, when we consider our tetrahedron T, so we take 8 copies, but then in fact we glue them along the coordinate planes. Right? And so the last part of this lemma is about sigmas. So each edge of T, so now lying aside, T first, has, so how many now? Good. Has four non-empty symmetric copies. And now, so each edge of T lying in a face has, well, for the same reason as before, we should just divide this 4 by 2. So we'll have 2 non-empty symmetric copies. And finally, each edge of T lying in an edge in fact, if our segment lies in an edge, we have only two symmetric copies of the segment, and exactly one of them is non-empty. So do this exercise. It's really easy to prove this this lemma. And now I hope you believe me that the early characteristic of our pink surface is determined by the degree, because you see we calculated all the numbers. So just we need now to calculate the early characteristic. So do the calculation. It's easy, so you should multiply 64 by 7, then this you should multiply by 6, this by 3, and so on. Take the alternating sum, and the result, you will see that the result will be minus 16. And you can easily generalize this calculation to arbitrary degree, and you will get the result I wrote here. So it will be minus d cube over 3 plus 4d over 3. Okay. So everything is clear concerning this to lemmas. Very good. So now let's notice. Let's come back to our problem after this calculation. I understand that it's difficult to do such a calculation early in the morning. But now this calculation is done, and let me recall you that our purpose is to construct a non-singular surface of degree 4 such that the real point set of the surface is the disjoint union of a sphere with ten handles and two-dimensional sphere. So my claim is that if I succeed to give you a convex primitive triangulation of our tetrahedron T and some distribution of signs, say that in our Pythagorean construction, I will see some sphere. So I will see in this pink surface a sphere. Then necessarily, the topology will be like this. So once again, my claim. So if Ax is constructed. So Rx is the real point set of a non-singular surface of degree 4. And we constructed this surface where the combinatorial Poisson procedure using a primitive triangulation . Now this is the first assumption, and the second assumption is that Rx contains a sphere . Then Rx is homeomorphic to the disjoint union. So of course, I'm speaking about the case of degree 4. This statement is not general. I'm discussing the combinatorial patchworking of surface degree 4. So this is a claim. Now the question, is a proof of this claim clear?
Well, there aren't that many maximal surfaces, so.
No, that's not, let's not use, first of all, the classification of maximal surfaces of degree 4, because I presented this classification, but we didn't prove it, right? In addition, I didn't say that my surface is maximal. But it is automatically, in fact. So my claim is that if we use a primitive triangulation and we see, well, in fact, I'm sorry, it's okay, yeah. So I don't need to add anything. So the claim is like this. So I just said that I'm constructing a surface of degree 4. I'm using a primitive triangulation. And in the real point set, I see a sphere. Then my claim that the surface is maximal and the real point set is homeomorphic to this disjoint union.
Yeah, basically, if you would have like a disjoint union of things that have lower genus, then you would never be able to get minus 16.
Yeah, so in fact, it's a game with one equality and one inequality. So first of all, we know that the early characteristic, which is B0 minus B1 plus B2 is equal to minus 16. And secondly, we know that the total Betti number, which is B0 plus B1 plus B2. And of course, B0 is equal to B2. Is bounded from above by 24. So you should just try to see what can be the possible values of B0, B1, and B2. So what do we know is that, under this assumption, that B0 is at least 2. Right? So we see some sphere. It cannot be 2, because the early characteristic of the sphere is 2, and in fact, the early characteristic is minus 16. So we have at least one other connected component. So we have this inequality. So in this expression, we have already 4 for coming from B0 and B2. Right? So B0 plus B2 is at least 4. And we need to get minus 16. So it means that B1 is at least 20. But thus, in fact, we have equalities, right? Because 2 plus 2 plus 20 is already 24. So it means that, in fact, B0 and B2 are equal to 2, B1 is equal to 20, so the topology is like this. Convincing? But before making this break, let's choose the distribution of signs in such a way that we would have a sphere of our pink surface. So this is T. We took some primitive triangulation of T, and now some convex primitive triangulation of T, if you want to use the combinatorial patchworking. And now I'd like to choose the distribution of signs in such a way that our pink surface, so the resulting pink surface, surface produced by this procedure, has a sphere. Well, it's extremely easy to do because just... Yeah. So inside this... You're completely right. Inside this tetrahedron T, there is, in fact, exactly one integer point. So this is a point with the coordinates 1, 1, 1. So let's choose the distribution of signs in the following way. Let's take minus at this point. So it's clear that this point is surrounded by a sphere of our pink surface. Because in the star of this this vertex in the triangulation leaves a small sphere. That's because all other vertices in the star are positive. They have the sign plus. So it's exactly as in the construction of Harnack curves we discussed some weeks ago. So if all the edges connect this this vertex to positive vertices, then we have a small pink sphere surrounding this point. And that's all. Thus, in fact, we don't need to look what happens in other corpus. So everything will work just because we know the early characteristic and we know the statement. So since we see the sphere, the topology of the result is definitely like this. There is one small gap in my arguments. So that's I would say that the gap is a little bit bigger. So of course I should worry about convexity of the triangulation, but I should also worry about the primitivity of this triangulation. So in fact, to finish my construction, I should explain you that in principle there exists a primitive convex triangulation of T. So any primitive convex triangulation of T will do for our construction, but we need at least one. So we need a primitive convex triangulation of t. And so try to think during the break why such a primitive convex triangulation does exist, and we will discuss this problem after the break. So let's make 10 minutes break. Okay, so let's continue. Are there any questions? Everything is okay? So let me describe a primitive convex triangulation of T. And I will do it for an arbitrary degree. It's not important for my description that D is equal to 4. So of course there are many primitive convex triangulations of T if the degree is greater than 1. So if the degree is 1, of course, there is only one such triangulation. But in general, there are many of them. But I will describe a particular primitive convex triangulation. And this, so my choice is, well, can be explained by, for example, for construction of maximal surfaces in arbitrary degree. And so since it's one of the exercises of the list, so you can consider this triangulation as a hint for the corresponding exercise of the list. So this triangulation allows one to construct a maximal surface in any degree, a maximal surface in IP3. So a primitive convex triangulation. So let's, for the moment, forget about T. Let's consider a prism so I agree that for the moment, it's not clear what the relation is, what do we need for our construction, but believe me, it will be useful. So this is a triangle. Okay, so let's denote this triangle by, I don't know, I'm out of letters already, so it's, let it be M, so a triangle. So this prim is M times I, so I is the interval, for example, 0, 1. And what do I need? I need a triangulation of this prism. So do you know, let's call it the standard triangulation of the product of a simplex and an interval? Two options, yes, no. Good. So, I will describe this triangulation in the case of triangle, but you will see that it works in general for any simplex. So let's, so my picture is a picture of M times I, and correspondingly, remember the vertices of m times 1. So, so we have this copy m times 0, m times 1. So let's number the vertices. Now we'll do the following. So we take the vertex. Okay, let's use some colors. So we take the vertex 0 of m times 1, and we consider the cone with this vertex over the triangle, which is m times 0. Now, the next element of the next tetrahedron of the triangulation is like this. Then we take the edge 0, 1 of the upper copy of our triangle and the edge 1, 2 of the lower copy. And once again, we take the join of these two edges, so if you want the convex hull. And the remaining part is in fact the cone with the vertex numbered by 2 over the lower copy over, or in my picture, under the triangle in which is m times 1. So I hope you see this 3 tetrahedron. So this is the standard triangulation of triangle times interval. So in fact, what happens in general, so if you have a k-dimensional simplex times our interval 0, 1, so you number the vertices of this simplex from 0 to k. So for the upper copy, for the lower copy. And then this standard triangulation, which depends only on this numbering, so the choice of the numbering of vertices, is like this. So you will have k plus 1, k plus 1 dimensional simplexes. Which are like this. For each I, for integer I between 0 and k, so you can take the face of this low, upper copy of my simplex with vertices numbered from 0 to I, and then the face of the lower copy with the vertices numbered from I to k, and you take the join of these two faces. This gives you a k plus 1 dimensional simplex. You have k plus 1 dimensional simplexes, and they form a triangulation of the product, exactly as in this picture. Very good. So now, what is the relation between this strange construction and a primitive convex triangulation of T? Well, so now let me draw T. So this is T. Now you can cut T in some prisms, just taking horizontal planes at all integer levels. So a typical prism will be like this. So you have here j and j plus 1. So you take the section of our tetrahedron at the level j plus 1 and at the level j. Well, this prism is slightly deformed, so it's so that these sides are not vertical, but of course for our combinatorial purposes this prism is perfectly okay. So we can consider a triangulation, this standard triangulation of this prism. And to have this standard triangulation, we need an order on the vertices, right? So we need this numbering, 0, 1, 2. Okay, so let's, for the moment, choose this numbering arbitrarily. So this will be, for example, 0, this will be 1, this will be 2. So the same for the upper copy. And now we consider this this subdivision. So of course this triangulation is not primitive. No way. But notice that if in this lower triangle and in the upper triangle I consider a primitive triangulation formed by three tetrahedra will be refined, in fact, in a primitive triangulation of our prism. So let's try to understand my statement in the case of this yellow cone. So let's consider the first tetrahedron of my triangulation, so this yellow one. So for the moment, it's just one tetrahedron, but assume now that the base is triangulated and this triangulation of the base is primitive. Then the cone over this primitive triangulation gives you a triangulation of this yellow tetrahedron, and this triangulation is primitive, right? Because if in the base the triangulation is primitive, the area of each triangle is 1/2. So in this refined triangulation of the cone, the volume of each tetrahedron will be 1/6, because this is 1. Is it clear? Well, it's completely similar for this green. I'm not sure that it's visible that this is green, but the last cone under this triangle is also refined, and we have a primitive triangulation of this third tetrahedron subdivision. What about this blue one? But if we have a primitive triangulation of this upper triangle, so we have a primitive triangulation of this edge. So a primitive triangulation of edge is a triangulation formed by segments of length 1, right? And the primitive triangulation of this edge. And you can easily check that it gives you a refinement, so it gives you a triangulation of this blue tetrahedron in appropriate number of primitive tetrahedra. So for each small tetrahedron in this subdivision, so each tetrahedron will be formed by an edge of length 1 in the upper copy and the edge of an edge of length 1 of the lower copy, and the volume of such tetrahedron is 1/6. Okay. So now coming back to this picture. So what I'm saying is that it's enough to choose a primitive convex, if we want to obtain a convex triangulation, primitive convex triangulation of the lower triangle of this prism, and the primitive convex triangulation of the upper part of this prism. And it gives you, if you use first this standard triangulation, then its refinement, it gives you a primitive, and it's easy to check, convex triangulation of this prism. Very good question. The answer is exercise. The hint, do you agree that this triangulation is convex?
Which one?
This. This. Formed by this three tetrahedron. So you can choose, so you should certify that this triangulation is convex. So you should choose the piecewise linear convex function which certifies that this triangulation is convex. So let's choose this function. So this function is like this. So it's identically zero on yellow tetrahedron. Then it's, so you choose the value, for example, one at this vertex. So you have zeros at this vertices, and so you extend to the blue tetrahedron your function in such a way that on the blue tetrahedron it's a fine linear. So it's, in fact, I just need to describe the values of my function at vertices, right? Because my function should be a fine linear on each tetrahedron of subdivision. So at this vertices it's zero, at this vertex is one, which guarantees that the graph is broken along this face, and then choose a sufficiently big value at this vertex, which guarantees you that the result is as you want. Just think about it. So this triangulation is trivially convex.
And the cone over a trivial convex.
Wait. So now, what I am saying that you have this function. You have a piecewise linear convex function certifying that this triangulation is convex. Now let's choose a primitive convex triangulation in this triangle. So we have a function, a piecewise linear convex function certifying that the triangulation of this triangle is convex. So you can, if you want, perturb this big function by this small function, so you should just add to this big function epsilon times the function certifying that the triangulation of the triangle is convex, where epsilon is positive, it's sufficiently small. So do this exercise. I think I described all the hints. So it's one of the advantages of this triangulation is it's really easy to prove that this triangulation is convex. You can construct a piecewise linear convex function certifying that this triangulation is convex. Well, and it's now it's finished. You do this construction at each prism you obtain. So for each pair of neighboring integer horizontal sections of T, you do this construction, and just to make sure that my description of a piecewise linear convex function certifying that my triangulation is convex works, it's better, so just think about it, it's better to alternate, in fact, the orderings of vertices when we go from one level to the neighboring one. So in fact, what I'm trying to say is that probably I should describe my construction in the case of dimension 2. And it will be, since you don't look to be convinced by the constructions in dimension three, especially with the discussion of convexity. Let's look in what happens. So let's look at dimension two. So what I'm describing in dimension two works in the following way. So if now we have a triangle with vertices 0, 0, d0, 0, d, so we cut this triangle by horizontal lines at each integer level. And between two neighboring levels, we have our prism. So now in dimension two, this prism combinatorially is just a square, right? So it's I times I. So of course we'll have, in fact, so the geometrically these are not squares, but combinatorially, so we have the squares, except the last level where we'll have just a triangle. So what is the standard triangulation of I times I? So if the numbering is like this, my general description gives this triangulation. So we take this diagonal, and now if we take a primitive triangulation of each of these two segments, it gives us a refinement. In fact, we have already seen this triangulation during the exercise session. Yeah? And so what I was saying about the alternation of the orderings, it's better to switch the diagonal all the time for some hidden reason. It's a little bit better to proceed in this way. For example, in this way, it's easier to prove that the triangulation is convex. And so that's exactly what we will do here. So for one pair of neighboring levels, we take one ordering. And for the next pair, we have the opposite one. So it will look like this. So here we have this yellow tetrahedron, which is the cone with this vertex over this lower triangle. And since I switch the ordering, the same vertex will serve for another tetrahedron. So for the next pairs of levels, I will take the cone with this vertex under this triangle. So just think about this construction. I think I described everything you need to know about this construction to reconstruct all the tetrahedra and to prove that this subdivision, this triangulation is convex. So it's clearly primitive, and I claim that it's convex. So it gives you an example of a primitive convex triangulation for any degree. In fact, you can easily generalize this construction to higher dimensions. So in fact, it gives you, inductively, it gives you a primitive convex triangulation in any degree and any dimension. And so it finishes our construction of maximal surface of degree 4 in IP3. So any questions about this construction? So there are some details to study, to recover in my description. So try to do this remaining exercises. What I'd like today, I'd like to start the second paragraph of the second chapter. And the second paragraph is about what is called Smith's theory. So I will call it Smith inequality. So we already used several times this inequality, so probably it's reasonable to prove it at some moment. So after this combinatorial discussion, so let's do a little bit of topology. So what I will present, it's a piece of what is called Smith theory. It works in quite a general setting. I will not try to put things in the most general possible setting. So let's take a finite simplicial complex and a simplicial involution of this simplicial complex. All the words are clear?
No. What's a simplicial
involution? A is clear.
No, all the words are clear, but yeah. What is simplicial involution? We don't know.
Simplicial complex, you know.
Yes.
So simplicial involution, so this is topological space. So it's an involution of this topological space. So it's particularly, it's a continuous map from X to X, which is an involution. So I guess your question is about simplicial. So it just means that each simplex is sent to a simplex. So since we are speaking about simplicial complex, it's natural to consider maps which preserve the simplicial structure. That's all.
It's not piecewise linear.
No.
So in principle, you can vary the definition, but the only thing I need is that each simplex is sent to the simplex. Okay. So if, in fact, probably to answer partially to your question, when I speak about simplicial complex. So for me, the simplicial complex is not necessarily what is called geometric simplicial complex. So it's not a collection of simplices in some Rn with some properties. It's topological space equipped with a homeomorphism with a geometric simplicial complex. So if you want, it's a topological space equipped with a triangulation. Yeah. So, in other words, with a homeomorphism, with a geometric simplicial complex. But don't worry if you don't like this setting. Take any setting you prefer. So, in fact, the statement will work for good topological spaces and good involutions. So, you should think about good topological spaces and good involutions. So, but to not to have problems, I prefer to work with finite simplicial complexes. But if you prefer, you can work with finite CW complexes and CW involution. So it's okay. So the notation will be like this. So F is the fixed point set of this this involution, and X prime is the quotient space. And so theorem so there exists an exact, well, like a short exact. Oh, okay. Let me write it this way: an exact sequence. And so it's a homological exact sequence, and so all homology groups to simplify notation, so all homology groups in Smith theory are with z over 2 coefficients. So this exact sequence is like this. So to simplify a little bit the notations, I will identify F with its image in the quotient space. So I will consider F is a subset of X and is a subset of X prime, right? Because F is naturally identified with its image in the quotient space. So for me, F can be seen as a subset of X prime. So it's so what is important for us? So I will not describe all the all the morphisms in the sequence. Something's wrong? Some homomorphisms are easy to explain. So BI is clear. So in fact, since we have this projection from X to X prime, we have a morphism from HI of X to HI of X prime, and then we can go to the relative homology. So composing the morphism induced by this projection and, well, the standard morphism from the sequence, exact sequence of pair X prime F. So beta I is exactly this morphism. It's also clear what is the second component, what should be the second component of gamma I plus one. So the morphism from this group to this one is just the boundary homomorphism, well, boundary homomorphism, I'm sorry. So from, once again, from the exact sequence of the pair X prime F. But surprisingly, already the existence of this sequence without description of morphisms is a strong statement. What I will use later, but I will formulate it now, what will be important for us at some moment is that sigma star, so of course this sigma star is a dangerous notation, since sigma is an involution from x to x, we have the induced morphism from, so for each I from h I of x to h I of x. And so my claim is, so the sigma star for me for the moment, x on h I of x. I don't want to put the index I, not to complicate my notation. So the claim is that it acts as identity on the image of alpha I. So in this group, you have the image of this morphism. My claim that sigma star on this image acts as identity. Well, I mean, my claim is that there exists such an exact sequence that this property is satisfied. So we will prove this this statement. Well, I will omit details, but I will explain you how to prove this statement, how to construct this exact sequence the next week. But let's today prove two corollaries. So first of all, I claim that let's write the total Betti number. So the total Betti number of x is equal to the total Betti numbers. So all the coefficients are z over two coefficients of f plus the sum of dimensions of co-kernels of alpha I twice. In particular, we have what is called Smith inequality. I'm just saying that this quantity is bounded from by this quantity. And also, these two quantities are congruent modulo 2. This is called Smith congruence. And the second corollary so I will discuss once again the proof of the statement the next week, but for the moment let's discuss briefly the corollaries. So the second corollary is that if we have equality in the Smith inequality, so in this case the involution sigma is called maximal. So in this case, Then, so for the moment, it will not be clear why I am formulating this corollary, but later we will use it. So then, sigma star acts as identity on hi of x for any I. And I hope it's also clear, if you believe that the theorem is true. Yeah, so if we have equality, then all the co-kernels are trivial, which means that, in fact, sigma star, in this case, acts as identity on the whole group hi of x for hi. So in fact, what we should prove, okay, let's take 3 minutes to discuss this the proof of the first corollary. Well, you just play with this exact sequence. So you write what is the dimension of hi of x. No, the dimension of hi of x can be written as the dimension of the co-kernel of alpha I plus the dimension of the image. Okay, so I will not have enough space here. So can I erase the second corollary? So the dimension of hi is really standard calculation. So this dimension is the dimension of the co-kernel of alpha I plus the dimension of the image of alpha I. But now we can, so this is something which appears in the identity you would like to get. So let's keep this term. And let's rewrite this as the what is the dimension of the image? Is the dimension of this vector space, so all the vector spaces are over z over 2, minus the dimension of the kernel. So if the dimension of hi x prime f plus the dimension of hi of f minus the dimension of the kernel, but since our sequence is exact, the kernel of this map is the same as the image of that map. So I will write the minus the dimension of the image of gamma I plus 1. And then I continue. So now I rewrite the dimension of the image. So I keep all these terms. And I rewrite this, and this dimension, so the dimension of the image of gamma I plus is the dimension of this vector space minus the dimension of the kernel. So it's minus the dimension of h I plus 1 f. And here it's minus the dimension of the kernel, which is the dimension of the image of beta i plus 1, so it's dimension. And now it remains to rewrite once again the dimension of the image of beta plus 1. So finally, it gives the dimension of the kernel. So the terms we had already. So it will be plus the dimension of the image of beta I plus 1. And so it means that it's the dimension of h I plus 1 dimension h I plus 1 of x, right? So so I'm with b plus 1, so I'm here, so I'm interested in the dimension of the image, so it's minus dimension of the image of alpha plus 1, and this is exactly the dimension of the co-kernel of alpha I plus 1. Well, that's all. So just look at this and this expression, and so write this equality for all I and take the sum. So I leave you this exercise to check that everything is okay on the in the extreme cases, but it's clear what will happen. You see this strange so dimension of this strange group minus dimension of h I plus 1, but since I will write this equality for all I's and then I will sum up, this will disappear, and so in the left-hand side I will have the total beta number of x, in the right-hand side I will have the total beta number of, so the sum of all these dimensions, the total beta number of f plus the twice the dimension of the kernel of alpha. Okay. So this gives the Smith identity. Smith's inequality and Smith's congruence. So it remains to prove the existence of this exact sequence. And as you will see the next week, in fact, as more or less always, you can find a short exact sequence of some complexes such that this exact sequence is the long exact sequence of that short exact sequence of complexes. And that's what we'll do the next week. And it gives immediately particular Smith-Thom inequality. So this inequality in the case of real algebraic varieties is called Smith-Thom inequality. So if we consider, for example, hypersurfaces, not to have problems, because I assume that my simplicial complex is finite, so my hypersurface will be in projective space. So if we have a hypersurface in IPN, an algebraic hypersurface in IPN, then we can apply this topological statement for the complex point set and the real point set of our hypersurface, and gives us this inequality we spoke about already several times, that the total Betti number of the real part is bounded from above by the total Betti number of the complexification. So that's all I wanted to say today. Are there any questions? So an exercise, try to guess what are these complexes in a short exact sequence of complexes which produce this long exact sequence. But we will discuss it the next week. Okay, so let's make a 7 minutes break, and then this will be an exercise session. In particular, we will discuss the construction of maximal curves of degree 7. So this exercise you try to do as a homework. And just one announcement, not to forget. So the next week there will be a small modification in the schedule of lectures. So the next week we'll have two lectures of this lecture course, one as always on Tuesday and one on Wednesday. So in fact we exchange with Sergey Galkin to make this exchange. So I will give two lectures the next week, and then one lecture the week after the next one, and then we will not have a lecture of this lecture course on, I guess it's something like December 20. So during the last week of the lecture course, there will be two lectures of Sergey Galkin's course, but no lectures of this lecture course. Is the exchange clear? So that's, and next Wednesday, we for this lecture, as always for this lecture course, we start with the lecture and then we do the exercises, right? So on Wednesday, the lecture will be at 9:15, as always.